expressly for educational or general information use only and is not intended to be used in lieu of medical advice or emotional therapy. You should regularly consult a physician or other licensed health care. The information provided by Dr. Josh Claypool is provided expressly for educational or general information use only and is not intended to be used in lieu of medical advice or emotional therapy. You should regularly consult a physician or other licensed health care provider concerning all matters that pertain to physical or mental health, particularly any symptoms that may require professional attention. Content on the web may not be suitable for younger audiences. Listener discretion is advised.
Love. Lust. Life. You've just entered the web with Tony Curry and Dr. Josh Claypool. Call 545-9950 or 844-455-9950 or tweet at the web 995 to get on the show.
Saturday night to you, my friend.
How are you?
Oh, fantastic, man. This is the web radio show here on Talk 99.5. It's Saturday night. It's all right for loving around here. We do it every single Saturday night from 7 to 10. Of course, your phone calls always very relevant. We'd love to have you on 545-9950-844-455-9950. And, of course, everyone appears on the TD's Fine Furniture couch, regardless of whether you're a special guest or not. We have two special guests. We'll get into them here in just a second, but first, we always start the show about what's going on with social media and all media. We had Dr. Josh Claypool, UAB clinical psychologist, NBC Nightly News, CBS, Fox, CNN, Shea Magazine, GQ, Bustle. What else?
Beachbody.com.
Beachbody.com is
a
new one.
It's a new one.
Beachbody.com is good.
We were in Beachbody.com this week, and we were in Bustle this week, this last week, and we were on thelist.com. I don't know if you ever follow The List. List is actually very good. It's a little bit like Cheat Sheet, but it's a little bit more in depth. And
is it like Ranker?
No. It's a little more along the lines of Bustle. But on The List, we were talking about how to basically dump somebody in a kind and gentle manner, and they reached out to the web for us on that one. For Bustle, it was how to fight right with your significant other, and Beachbody was how to be mindful about weight loss, mind tricks to lose weight. Because, see, I'm a shrink, so they can ask me. I can go in, I can go arguing.
You do it all. I mean, it's more than just relationships. Now, you know more now for this show than you were at...
Yes. Yes, I do.
He is UAB clinical psychologist, but, I mean, they're not bringing you in for those anymore, are they?
No.
But, I mean, that's great for UAB, right?
No, UAB is very supportive of it, but this is... We are becoming recognized much more as a relationship show, and we're contributing to relationship questions and problems, including messages that we get and TV and all kinds of stuff.
All right, biggest problem fighting. When you said this article, what's the biggest mistake that most of us make when we argue?
We go from trying to get a point across to wanting to win. It happens almost unconsciously. And that's what we basically go from a disagreement.
Is it wanting to win
fight
or being right?
That's the progression. So the first is we think we're right.
Yeah.
Well, the first is we're having a discussion.
Uh-huh.
Then in that discussion, we think one of us thinks we're right. And then it goes to I want to be right and get my point across to I'm going to be right. And then it goes to I'm going to win. And all of that can happen like that quick. And it happens with a whole lot of emotion behind it. So you basically go from a disagreement to a fight. And once you start fighting with your significant other, there is no winner. You will never win when you get to the fight part.
Now, women have this Rolodex brain where they can go back and pull crap up from 15, 16, 17 years ago, and they like to bring it back. And we're used to doing that over on because we're analytical. We think about numbers and stats and why is this team going to be good, why is this team going to be bad. And you look at the past to predict the future. With a relationship, it's not that I get over things very, very quickly, but if I'm going to be told I'm doing something wrong and I know they've done the same thing, then my brain starts going back. Well, remember that back in March of a couple of years ago? And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, you're going to bring that crap up again. How
do
you get through that?
You just shift one, and then the adrenaline
But you got to make your argument.
Once emotions go, it's done. Once emotions go, and I'm not saying that it's not next to impossible, but that's how we get into fights. The way we get into fights is we go from having the discussion to the adrenaline starts going. And that's why men tend to be worse in it, because our adrenaline kicks in faster. We go more on the offensive. And in our brain, and I challenge every guy who's listening to this, in our brain, we tend to go from the discussion to, wait a minute, I'm right at this. Wait a minute. And then we're fighting. And we're fighting in our brain. I'm going to win, meaning I'm going to get my point across. And that's when it's all done.
He's Dr. Josh Claypool. I'm Tony Curry. Do a show on Jocks 94.5 along with Alan Jay Monday through Fridays. We do this web show here every Saturday night from 7 to 10. Have a blast. It's wide open. We don't apologize for anything. We just tell you like it is. He basically gives you all the scientific and the psycho stuff, which is fantastic. I try to drive it off the road. All right, makeup sex, always good? Always good, right?
If it's
consensual,
yeah.
Even if the argument's not over, it's always good,
if
right?
That's
going to bed, not
joint angry. Agreed. If you agreed together to have makeup sex, yeah.
Percentage of people that argue just to have makeup sex?
Probably about 25%.
Really?
To start an argument, yeah, just to have makeup sex?
If you know you're going to get it every time you argue?
You're not going to get it every time you argue.
No, but I mean, if you know you are.
No, but
if it's,
you're not.
What if it's part of the deal? Hey, listen, I'm not going to go to bed angry, so we might as well just go ahead and...
That doesn't last very long.
Well, it should be a
deal. No, particularly if they know that that's where I'm going to argue so that I'm going to get makeup sex.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, that's good. They're going to find you out like that.
I don't know if you would look in the Urban Dictionary under pink breakfast.
But I know what that is.
Those two words are making the rounds around the city and around the Southeast because of our guest at 9 o'clock tonight. We're moving Laura Korn's fantastic. She wrote a best-selling book called 101 Nights of Great Sex. Tap Tease to Do. She's got an app, and of course, 101nights.com, 101nights.com. You go to her website. She sold over 5 million books. She's fantastic.
It's a New York Times bestseller.
Exactly. So she joined our show last show and was talking about this maneuver, which quite frankly made me uncomfortable, which is almost impossible to make me uncomfortable. It really is. And I was like, license. Think about the license. Think about saving the license. And so she obviously got a lot of podcasts, a lot of hits on her particular, and she sounds great. She looks great. She's very successful. She does. So she's going to join us at 9 o'clock
just
for her weekly
later.
Segment. Just a little late. We're going to move around a little bit because I think she likes to be moved around. But she's going to start giving us a maneuver of the week.
Oh, I love it.
So every week she's going to give us a maneuver, and last week it involved
coffee
and Sunday morning.
Yes.
That's really all I got to tell you.
And it was being talked about not only amongst the larger community,
yeah.
But I can tell you on at least one other talk show on this station, it was also being talked about during news, etc.
If it's a great rock and roll show, it's coming through Mountain Entertainment, our spotlight of the week.
Right.
We're going to start a brand new segment starting here in about 46 minutes. Jay Wilson from Red Mountain Entertainment is going to join us here talking about Sloss Fest. We'll have some tickets to be given away. John Legend, Rod Stewart, Def Leppard, Soundgarden. You go to their site, redmountainentertainment.com, and you can see it all, and it's incredible how many shows they do, and they do them all over the Southeast. So he's going to join us around 8 o'clock, and also, of course, we have some audio. You didn't even think to play this.
No.
Until we were on the phone a couple hours ago, and I said, dude, that's gold. It's radio gold, and I don't even want to set it up.
You're the radio this is why you're here. You're the radio professional.
So Fox News does this the Lucky Man segment or whatever it airs. Like, it's great. It's like three or four women with skirts up at their necks and one guy. And they're talking news, and they can pull it off, and it's just fun to watch. I mean, they're all hot.
Network.
It's great. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so you were on with three anchors on Fox News here locally.
Yeah.
And asked these ladies to stick something in their mouths. And it was small and wrinkly. We're going to have that audio for you in 15 minutes at 7:30. If you missed this segment, you got to hear it. Because if you don't know what it is, it sounds like it'd be something you could lose your license over.
It was on live TV.
All right, 7:15 here on Talk 99.5. Up here next, why you don't want to mess the man. Charms. We'll talk about it right here on the web on Talk Dinner 95.
You're in the
bail after pleading guilty. She never showed up at her sentencing hearing. Evidently, she admitted putting boric acid, a poison used to kill cockroaches and other pests, in her husband's Lucky Charms last week. Not to kill him, just enough boric acid to make him not have an erection. She didn't want to have sex with this man, and so she evidently just started putting boric acid, and he had diarrhea every day for around 6 months, also suffered unexplained nosebleeds and bleeding from other orifices of his body. And I'm thinking to myself, I understand sometimes women just aren't in the mood.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I see there's always two sides to this particular story.
Yeah.
Her ex-husband, now his ex-husband, identified only as Ralph, is now calling for authorities to find his fugitive ex. He said, "I was very surprised. I thought we had a better system of keeping track and holding people responsible. I was really surprised she tried to kill me, but instead tried to find her." And so I'm thinking to myself, how many people out there do different things
like
so
that?
They don't, well, not so much
oh,
that
yeah,
far.
That's, dude, that's
no,
like,
I mean, that's
Craig,
well, I mean, she obviously knew kind of what she was doing, and she evidently was a stewardess, and he said, I kind of knew something was up because I knew
that
when
I was
she was
bleeding.
A stewardess at one point, she had told me that she was doctoring people's drinks on a flight because they were complaining about something, like move me from the seat or whatever, and so she was putting Visine or whatever in their drinks.
Red flag.
Exactly. And I'm not saying that women, but how often do we try to come up with excuses and different things to ensure that we don't have to be with our partner? First of all, red flag for the relationship. I don't know if it's something where he wanted three times a day.
That's the headache. I'm tired. I'm not in the mood. I guess that's not an excuse. I'm not in the mood. I'm tired.
It's not?
Is that an excuse? Or is that just the truth?
Well, if it's the truth, it's okay. Now, if you're tired all the time, then you got an issue.
No. I said I'm not in the mood.
Yeah.
That's the truth. I'm tired. I'm headache. Kids are upstairs.
I could not think of another reason why a woman would want to put boric acid in his Lucky Charms.
She's crazy, dude. But she's crazy.
But he married her, though. I mean,
okay. So he's either naive, stupid, or something else. But she's crazy. I mean, because of what you just said, if she was trying to kill him, she'd still be crazy. But you understand the rationale. But she put boric acid in his Lucky Charms so that she didn't have to have sex with him.
But she was, again, she wasn't trying to mess him up. She was just trying, I guess she read somewhere that boric acid affects your erection. And so she was like, okay, I need to find something that.
So, but when he said, maybe ahead of her
make
sweet.
It makes you think, though, if he took a blue pill, in fact, obviously I've got some ED issues.
Yeah.
That he could have just died. Well, because he's bleeding.
But what if he said, that's what he said to us, I'm bleeding from my rectum. I wonder why that's happening. And she didn't stop, you know? I mean,
And I knew this
crazy,
was,
crazy, and he should have run and run fast.
And I knew this would provoke a phone call, 545-9950. George wants to talk about murdering his wife. George, what's going on, man? Welcome to the web here on Talk 995. How are you?
Hey, it's been months since I called you guys. I'm in a 35-year marriage, and I'm 65 years old. The old lady don't put out no more, so, you know, that's a given. You know, you get older, and I listen to a lot of Christian programming, and there's one in particular, I can't remember the guy's name, but that must be an issue because he's brought that up, you know, about murdering your better half. When you get older and you still got insurance, you know, that's the standing joke between she and I now is which one of us is going to die first,
right.
You know, to collect the insurance. And I tell her, hey, heaven's going to be better than this, and, you know, and so, I mean, we can do a stand-up comedy routine. I mean, we bicker like, and we always have. We she's got mental problems to begin with. I mean, you know, and never has. She's one of these excessive compulsive detailers, and you know, it takes you. She can spend 20 minutes trying to organize a box when I just snatch it and go. You know.
But George, you've been married, would you say you've been married 30 years?
35 years.
35 years, and you said she doesn't put out, but you...
Not anymore. I mean,
when did she stop putting out?
Well, she's had surgery here in the last 4 years.
Okay, so she was good for the first 30 years.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, like drunk monkeys, man, we had a blast. And, I mean, you know, and I've got 6 grandkids, I've got 3 kids. You know, so that's my prodigy. I mean, you know, But that's life. That's the way it is. You get older, you need to think about these kind of things because, you know, life is not the barrel of fun that you think it is, you know.
But George, so, George, you sound pretty, like, in a good place about that. I mean, you're not only complaining, but that's okay with you?
Well, I mean, you know, I hide guns from her. I'm not going to let her have a gun. I don't think she'd ever pull one on me anyway, but, you know, of course, that's one of my pet peeves about a firearm. It needs to be locked up. But, you know, she loves me. I know she does. I don't think she'd do me harm. She spends more time aggravating me to try and make things, you know, really good for me, and it really aggravates me. So, yeah, it's I'm good with life. I'm 65 years old. I mean, you know, I still got a good libido, but, you know, it's just part of life. You just have to put up with life. And, you know, I walked. I got great blood pressure. Of course, I'm not the stallion I used to be, but, you know, I'd like to find more time now that I'm retired to get out on a mountain bike, you know, go to the gym. And I just can't find time. I mean, she's locked me down for the last week and a half over taxes. And we're, you know, we could have just done a short form. And, I mean, she is so meticulous and fits.
So you're good. You're good if this is the way it goes and it just gets a little worse and you're together for another, say, 15, 20 years and you kick the bucket, you're good?
I guess so, yeah. I guess, well.
You know, you kind of answered the question there. You guess so. You shouldn't be, right?
Yeah, no, but, George.
Well, yeah.
But are y'all close? Are y'all intimate in any way? I mean, you told me that you got a good, strong libido. She doesn't put out anymore, but are y'all close? Do you any sort of intimacy at any?
No.
No. So what do you do with all that energy?
Masturbate. That's
okay.
That's about all you can do. You
that,
know?
I just, and you seem quite content.
Who doesn't do that?
I know the danger of getting hooked up with the opposite sex. I mean, you know, I realize that there are some women out there that might be just horny, but, it's dangerous to fool with a female. I mean, you know, it really is. I mean, you look at me. I 35 years of misery. And, I mean, you know, God's laughing about it. I told John Ed Willoughby before he died a joke one time. God came into the Garden of Eden, saw Adam, and says, "Hey, Adam, how was that sex?" And Adam said, "Oh, God, it was great." He says, "Well, where is Eve?" And he said, "She's down at the creek washing up." And he said, "Oh, no, there goes the fish."
All right, George, thank you for the phone call. We appreciate that much. Thank you very much.
Thanks, George. Have a good night. Man, he just told us straight out like he is. That's what I love about this show.
But this is exactly what we talked about on one of our first shows, and that is you're at someone's funeral, and you're like, he was a loving husband and a father. They were married for 57 years. Like, gosh, how in the world they make it 57 years? It doesn't mean it was happy.
Yeah, but I don't know that he's not. I'm telling you.
He just said he's been miserable for 35.
No, he said it's been miserable. He didn't say he was miserable.
Well, he's finding different things to keep him happy.
Yeah. So that that's a relationship. Like that. So listen to his words, and then listen to his tone. That's why I was asking. He's like, you know, we haven't had sex in 4 years, and she doesn't put out, and there's a thing.
But there's a reason why he called the show.
Yeah.
I mean, if he was good, he wouldn't have called, right?
I don't
know.
Come
on, Josh. I mean, he's calling. He was reaching out. He was crying for help here.
No, I think it's not as bad as you make it sound to be.
But I also think that sometimes you find different things to do to make yourself happy in hopes that the ebb and flow of the relationship comes back around. And after 35 years, it doesn't do that.
No, he's got his hand.
Speaking of ebb and flow, what happens when Josh Klapo asks three women to put something small and wrinkly in their mouth? You'll hear the audio next right here on Talk That at 95 is The Web on Saturday night, 7 to 10 with Curry and Klapo. 855-450-844-455-9950. Thanks to George for taking the show off the rails again before 7:30. We almost do that almost every Saturday night now, don't we? I mean, the first half an hour is almost crucial to listen to find out what this show is all about, and then it's like, oh,
roller coaster in the dark.
At the web 995, thewebradioshow.com. Feel free to give us a buzz, and as always, if you have any questions, it could be anonymous, and it could be anything related. We kind of have a subcurrent of the show we kind of talk about a little bit. Tonight we're talking about some fantasies and different things, and but you don't have to go that direction. So
nope.
If you want to talk about anything, feel free to give us a buzz. We're on till 10 o'clock every Saturday night from 7 till 10. 8 o'clock, Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week. Jay Wilson's going to be in the studio. We'll have some Sloss Fest tickets to be given away. Cannot wait for that show coming up there for a couple of days on the 15th and 16th. So we'll have that going on. Laura Korn, I keep wanting to call her Dr. Laura Korn. She'd probably consider herself a doctor. She'll have the Maneuver of the Week. Really, we just kind of, she's a New York best-selling author. She's got the book, 101 Nights of Great Sex, and we extended the invitation for her to call the show because she sounds good, she looks good,
she knows her stuff.
Gwyneth Paltrow, she's great friends with her, Barbara Walters.
Britney Spears
is a copy of her book by her nightstand. I mean, this woman's big time. She's out in Santa Monica. And then last week, or the last show we did, she called in with this maneuver, and now all of a sudden she wants to do the Maneuver of the Week. I'm like, well,
that's perfect.
That's why we're pushing.
We're
her
here
back
to help.
At 9 o'clock.
We're here to help.
All right, speaking of maneuvers, you do a lot of different things with a lot of local TV stations around here.
Yes.
You do stuff on the Weather Channel,
yep.
NBC Nightly News. You've been everywhere. You've done it all. And so, so you send me this clip of you along with three ladies on Fox 6, local channel WBRC.
Yep.
And I'm watching it, and I'm thinking, I can't believe, first of all, I thought, I can't believe these women are falling for this. Because it looks like a guy walking up to a girl at a bar and saying, here, I got this trick I want you to try. Just trust me. Just do this for me.
Right.
And they fell for it, but there is some science.
You messing with it.
Well, of course I'm messing with it.
You're messing with
it. Okay, so I'm not even going to tell people. I'm not even going to set this up. I'm just going to let them listen to it and see what it sounds like.
Yes.
This is Dr. Josh Klapo, UAB clinical psychologist and co-host of the Web Radio Show, talking to a couple of Fox 6 anchors. When was this?
This past Thursday.
All right, go ahead and let it roll.
When is the last time you actually looked at a raisin?
Never.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles, to the size, and actually process that in your brain. That's the first thing. Second thing. You're going to smell the raisin. Yes,
really?
Yes, you are. Yes,
that
it smells like a raisin.
There
it smells like a raisin.
A
but you're going to pay attention to what are the smells. Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel? What does it actually smell like? You're going to put it in your mouth. You're going to taste the raisin. I'm going to find out if you're choked doing this. Do not chew the raisin yet.
Oh.
How does it feel in your mouth? Okay.
I already started chewing.
How does it feel in your mouth? What's the texture like? What are the flavors like?
Jill, how did you get out of this?
As you're chewing it now, how does that change? Mm-hmm. Now you swallow the raisin, pay attention to it going down, and now you're going to summarize in your brain, what did you just experience? What did it look like? Pay attention for a minute, remember. What did it smell like? What did it taste like? And what did it feel like as you were eating it?
Oh, come on. Gotta have the video.
So cut that up, David. We're going to run bits of that throughout the entire show. So, all right, First of all, the one woman nailed it by saying, how did you get out of this? Of all the things you could have used, it had to be a raisin. I guess it could have been any type of fruit or anything else, correct? And now explain. Play it again one more time. Now play it, David. Play it one more time because I think I missed part of it. This is Dr. Josh Klapo.
When was the last time you actually looked at a raisin?
Never.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles, to the size, and actually process that in your brain. That's the first thing. Second thing, you're going to smell the raisin. Yes,
really?
Yes, you are. Yes,
that
it smells
much.
Like a raisin.
There's,
it smells like a raisin.
A fragrance.
But you're going to pay attention to what are the smells? Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel? What does it actually smell like? You're going to put it in your
like
mouth.
Caramel.
You're going to taste the raisin. I'm going to find out the choke doing this. Do not chew the raisin yet. How does it feel in your mouth?
Okay. I already started chewing.
How does it feel in your mouth? What's the texture like? What are the flavors like?
Jill, how did you get out of this?
As you're chewing it now, how does that change? Mm-hmm. Now you swallow the raisin, pay attention to it going down, and now you're going to summarize in your brain, what did you just experience? What did it look like? Pay attention for a minute, remember. What did it smell like? What did it taste like? And what did it feel like as you were eating it?
Did they know what you were doing?
Yeah. Well, it wasn't.
How in the hell did you get three good-looking women to do this on
because
television?
Because it had to do, it's a raisin meditation. It had to do with mindful eating.
I didn't twist it. I wasn't even there. I mean, you're the one that sent me the clip, and I'm like, you got to be kidding me. This is a great bar trick. So, I mean, if I could get three women to open a box of raisins and explain it the way you did and tell them it's raisin meditation.
It's raisin meditation.
That's something special
I
here.
Went to school for many years for that.
So you're going to pay attention to the wrinkles, to the size, process that in your brain.
So first of all, the good thing is, although now Maddux has just reminded me, I was going to say, this is really good that we're not on TV right now so people can see this, although we are streaming live on Facebook.
Yeah.
So you can see me turning red and dropping my head and all that. This was part of the same thing I did for Beachbody.com, how to eat more mindfully. And I was doing a demonstration of a raisin meditation. Raisin meditation.
But it could be anything, right? But it was just so happened a raisin.
Well, it just happened to be a raisin. It's easier to carry your raisins with you than if it's something else.
Did they have any idea what you were going to do?
Yeah.
You told them during the break, I'm going to have you stick a raisin in your mouth and tell me how it feels.
No, they just knew I was doing a raisin.
It's a good damn
they knew
thing
I was
did.
Doing a raisin meditation. They didn't know what it was. And not all the anchors knew that they were going to participate in the raisin meditation experience.
In television 10, 15 years ago, when you had cameramen and guys rolling the... You would not have gotten through that segment. Because there was probably nobody in that TV studio.
No, there were. And there were smiles. I mean, it was one of those things where...
It's a Mark Prater wiener dog thing.
That's what I mean. So you've had this on radio, I'm sure. And this is the first time I've ever had this on TV. As I was doing it, there was just this part of my brain, the little immature... adolescent male.
A little immature, yeah, okay.
Who as I was saying it started to get in my brain just a little bit. And then I made it go way back away so that I could get through because we only have, on TV, that whole segment, the entire segment, you got 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And I felt the giggles coming. But
there were a couple of words in there that were pretty Freudian.
Oh, yeah.
How does it feel in your mouth? What's the texture like? What are the flavors like?
Joe, how did you get out of this?
There were some Freudian phrases in there that didn't need to be used for this particular segment.
They slipped.
Don't swallow the raisin. Don't.
What are the smells? Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel? What does it actually smell like?
It smell like caramel.
Here's the thing. Yeah. This was legit. Just like this was. This is mine. You can go Google raisin meditation now. When Laura calls, I don't know if there are other sort of raisin meditations that she may describe that I would not describe. But this was to teach you to eat and pay attention to what you're eating in a more mindful way. You have chosen to use it for our show for other purposes.
I haven't said it. I just wanted people to hear it because I'm trying to help my partner out.
Oh,
I just
wanted
to pay attention to it going down. Mm-hmm. And now you're going to summarize in your brain, what did you just experience? What did it look like? Pay attention for a minute. Remember.
Got to go out
what
to
did it smell like? What did it taste like?
The good thing
and
is
what did it feel like?
If you go to the video, if you go to either, I think you go to my webpage, joshclaypool.com, or just Google WBRC, Mindful Eating, and my name, you'll see I brought my own little container of raisins. No, I didn't bring the box. I had a little special container.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles.
And I handed out my raisins to each person. And
you're going to pay attention to the wrinkles.
Okay, can we move on?
I really don't want to. I can go till 10 o'clock with this. I think David's having a good time in there, too.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles,
SNL
to the
made
size,
it,
and actually process that in your brain.
All right, so
Is this better than sweaty balls?
Let's be serious here. See, I'm not taking it there. I'm trying to lose weight here. Let's clean it all up. Are you telling people that when they eat, they're supposed to feel the texture and keep it in their mouth for a little while before they swallow and all that stuff? It doesn't matter whether it's raisins or not.
That's right. So the biggest problem, one of the biggest problems we have in this country is we eat too much crap, too much of it, too fast. And the idea behind mindfulness is to learn how to experience all of your food, meaning the sights, the sounds, the smells, the taste, the textures, because just doing that, not only will it slow you down, but it helps you, you become more fulfilled. And I'm going to pivot. It is not unlike how you should experience intimacy.
How does it feel in your mouth?
It's not how... Think about it.
All right, I'll bite.
So sometimes you just want a hamburger and you just snarf it down and it's just good, done, wonderful, it's over.
Yeah.
But really, when you're thinking about love, you're thinking about intimacy, you should savor it. It should... It's not that it has to last for an hour or 2 hours, but you should savor it. The sights, the smells, the texture. So actually, now the more that I think about it, this is totally applicable to intimacy recommendations. Raisin meditation can be used for both mindful eating and sex. There you go.
You brought it all around, full circle.
That's my job, man.
That's great. And keep putting those drops throughout the show. 7:44. We got some special guests coming up here at 8 o'clock. Laura Korn's going to join us at 9 o'clock. She is a best-selling author. She sold over 5 million books. She's going to join us at 9 o'clock, live from Santa Monica. And Jay Wilson from Red Mountain Entertainment, the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight. He's going to join us as well, and he's going to be throwing some free tickets at us every single week. We're looking forward to a bunch of great shows they're going to be doing. He'll join us here in just about 15 minutes here at The Web on Talk 95.
You're in The Web. to the web.
749 here on the web, at the web 995 on Twitter, thewebradioshow.com, 545-995-0844-455-9950. Saturday night's all right for loving it. We're going to do it here. We've had a couple phone calls. We'll always move to the top. The Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week. We got five shows we'll talk about. There's probably 100 on their website, theredmountainentertainment.com. You can check it out. And we'll have Jay Wilson coming up here at the top of the hour. We'll also have some Sloss Fest tickets to be given away. We had George on earlier, and I love taking phone calls and kind of deviating off and flanging out or whatever you want to call it.
Flanging.
Octopusing arm out. But he mentioned the fact that, of course, he'd been married for 35 years, and he hadn't been getting any in the last 5 years, which is something that happens to a lot of people. And obviously, kids play into that. And then, you know, it used to be the 7-year itch, then it's the 12-year itch, then it's the 20-year itch. But he did mention something that I thought was pretty interesting about relationships that's unintimacy related. He mentioned his wife is becoming very compulsive, that she will pack a box, for example, and she'll look through it over and over and over again to make sure it's just right, where he'll just pick the box up and split.
Yep.
That seems to be pretty relevant in a lot of couples as they get older. My mom couldn't leave anything alone. And she wasn't like that early in the relationship. As she got older, she would get it. And men almost seem like they go the opposite direction. How do they hook up?
Do
women just basically get more compulsive as they get older?
Not necessarily. That's what I was going to ask you. I mean, so one thing that happens as you get older, you definitely get more ingrained, more prominent, more your characteristics just sort of. The good stuff is there, but the bad stuff becomes more prominent. You set in your ways was the way I was looking at it. If your mom was meticulous all her life, as she gets older, that meticulousness may turn into a little bit of kind of obsessive compulsive type stuff. It's not common for women to just, you know, as a gender, become more detail oriented, unless husband is becoming sort of forgetful, slob, forgetting to, you know, wipe around the toilet, zip his zipper, all those kinds of things. In other words, he's becoming more of a slob, so she's becoming more of a sort of OC, keep things tight
is
together.
Is that standard protocol? Because, I mean, whenever you look at, say, even movies, you see old couples that have been together for 40, 50 years. He's like, oh.
Yeah.
And she's always being, no, we got to do this right. Now, clean up your...
It's really interesting. I mean, men tend to, we tend to get pretty relaxed in our relationship, in all aspects. I'm talking just interesting. And so you kind of see it that way. And what I think is even more interesting is you'll talk to women who've been married for 30, 40 years. And they'll say, it's getting worse and worse and worse. You know, he's more of a slob. He doesn't pay attention to himself. He doesn't pay attention to this house. He doesn't even, he doesn't wipe the food off of his mouth. But then she's busy wiping the food off his mouth for him. So she in other words, she's upset. She can't stand it. You get her alone and honest, and it's driving her berserk. But instead of sort of being a partner, if you will, she's being a mother. He becomes more of a baby. She becomes more of a mother. So, I mean, the way he's kind of... And I don't know if she's got
OCD.
And
isn't that what attracted him in the first place?
Well, every man in the beginning...
They want their mama, right?
Just a piece of it. They want mama. They want someone to take care of them. And for women, the challenge is, look, if you want to be nurturing, that's great. If you want to take care of him, that's great. But once you start getting... As a woman, once you start getting upset about that, once he starts doing things that are making you irritated, that are sort of ticking you off, the more you accommodate, the more you teach him how to treat you, the more he's going to. And so you see these relationships, and the house was, everything's fine. She's miserable, or she's got an anxiety disorder, or she's drinking, or she's taking meds. And he's just fat and happy. It's all good, because I don't even have to wipe my mouth.
Does it bother you when you hear someone like George Cullen and say they've been together for 35 years and he just sounds like, I mean, he's finding joy in life, and I think that's a very important thing, but he was reaching out. I mean, he called the show And we were talking about the woman who put boric acid in her husband's Lucky Charms. He was calling out saying he hadn't gotten any in 5 years. We're good. I don't think she'd ever hurt me, but I did put a lock on my gun, and I think we're getting along pretty good. I think she did, but I know we kind of bicker back and forth on how who's going to die first because heaven's going to. So there was a little pain there.
Oh, yeah.
But the guy's in his 60s. He's not dead yet.
Right.
And he's still got a libido, so he kind of threw out a clue there, too.
But then, think about it. What's going through his head? And he also threw out the idea, I'm not going to mess with other women. Right? He said, I'm not going to mess because that's dangerous. And he's also saying that's not right. But so think about it. So you're right. He is a little stuck. He's got a libido. He's not dead. I'm sure he loves his wife. But no, he's probably not as happy as he could be. But what's he going to do? Think about it. What is he going to do? Is he going to get divorced?
See, and I would think a lot of women, if his wife heard him say, well, I'm not going to mess with other women, she's right away thinking he's probably thinking about messing with other women. Well,
she
at least I'm
be.
Not cheating on her.
No, but I think that was pretty sincere. No, he's what he
well,
said.
But it doesn't matter whether it's sincere or not. I think it's true.
Yeah.
But why would you throw that out if you hadn't thought about it?
Well, in the context of what he was talking about us, he said, I masturbate instead of messing around with other women. And that's why I'm saying, his world...
But does he think about her while he's doing it?
I don't know. Maybe he'll call back.
They say it's been a long time since you had sex if you're actually masturbating and you think about your wife.
Wow. Listen. For George, the question is... Listen,
there's Jay Lopez. Next thing you know, your wife walks in on your fantasy. You're like, what are you doing here, for God's sake?
What is he going to do? Think about it from... That's what he's saying. I mean, that's kind of underneath. That's what he's saying is...
You're going to start getting calluses, what you're going
to
do.
No, he's going to say this is as good as it's going to get. Now, where I would argue is if I had him and his wife in front of me, right? If I had him and his wife... you don't know that this is as good as you're going to get. Because I guarantee you they haven't had all of the right conversations in the right way if this is where they're at right now. Because at age 65, it does not mean... That you can't be intimate anymore, that you can't have sex, that you can't lust after your wife, that your wife can't be pleased. All of that is completely not only possible, it is healthy and needed. But what George has done is said, look, I love my wife, this is as good as it's going to be.
It sounds like...
I need his wife on the phone.
But yeah.
She needs to call us back.
Good luck, man.
Okay, sorry.
She's probably packing a box, making sure it's perfect.
Well, and then if she's got OCD... Which I don't know. That's a huge problem.
He sounded like he was settling, though.
Yes, he is. He's settling.
Yeah, I would bet he calls the show again.
Well, I want him to call the show. I've got more to talk about.
I wonder how many couples, though, are out there feeling the same way, though.
Tons.
Because in your 60s, you're like...
There's a difference between settling and resolving versus we're content with the way we are. We're both content. Not, I think she's content or I know she's content and I'm good. Get them alone. Ask them both. And what they say together is very different than they say.
That was a great first hour. We're going to be on for 2 more hours. We're on from 7 to 10 every single Saturday night right here on Talk 99.5's The Web Radio Show, 545-9950 at The Web 995, and also thewebradioshow.com. Jay Wilson from Red Mountain Entertainment, the Spotlight of the Week, a brand new segment. We're excited. Coming up here next on Talk 99.5's The Web. expressly for educational or general information use only and is not intended to be used in lieu of medical advice or emotional therapy. You should regularly consult a physician or other licensed health care provider concerning all matters that pertain to physical or mental health.
Do you want to eventually doctor it up and get some like cool audio underneath or cool music under it?
Cool. For younger audiences, listener discretion is advised.
Love. Lust. Life. You've just entered the web with Tony Curry and Dr. Josh Klapo. Call 545-9950 or 844-455-9950 or tweet at the web 995 to get on the show.
How big are those guys' raisins right there, Ken Osborne? Good God, why? I mean,
look at you.
I've been doing radio for 38 years. That's people like, are like, man, you got great pipes. I'm like, those are the mighty pipes right there.
A little voice envy.
Does all the stuff over at TBS, TNT, movie trailers, and he's talking about the web on Talk 99.5. That's pretty cool.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles?
Exactly. And he has no wrinkles.
And he's never, that's forever, right?
Can we play that again before we get into our Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight?
Oh, my God.
Josh
when was the last time you actually looked at
Josh
a raisin?
Never.
You're
going
to pay attention to the wrinkles, to the size, and actually process that in your brain. That's the first thing. Second thing, you're going to smell the raisin. Yes,
really?
Yes, you are. Yes,
that
it smells
much.
Like a raisin.
There's,
it smells like a raisin.
A fragrance.
But you're going to pay attention to what are the smells? Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel? What does it actually
like
smell
caramel.
Like?
What the
you're
going to
put it in your
about?
Mouth.
Being mindful.
You're
going to
taste the raisin. I'm going to find out the trouble doing this. Do not chew the raisin.
Like caramel apples?
How does it feel in your mouth? Okay.
How
does it feel in your mouth? What's the texture like? What are the flavors like?
Jill, how did you get out of this?
As you're chewing it now, how does that change? Mm-hmm. Well, now you swallow the raisin, pay attention to it going down, and now you're
going to
summarize in your brain, what did you just experience? What did it look like? Pay attention for a minute, remember.
It's about
what
being
did it smell like? What did it taste like? And what did it feel like as you were eating it?
I got to object. Mine were given to me by the producer for free food.
She had bad raisins. She is the,
she says she was just doing the producer's raisins?
Let me tell you.
I didn't catch that the first time.
Yeah, let me tell you. They are, this was such a good segment, and they were such good sports about it.
You'll never
and
be invited back. I got news for
and
you.
And their producer was fantastic to let me, I mean, again, you know, when you're talking news, you get 2 minutes. And so I think we got like 220, which is, you know, that's like, like golden raisins.
Right, you should come in with a bag of marshmallows next week to see what happens.
Oh, you're going to go home and try it. I know you are. You can go home. You can go home because you got kids. You can go home and you're gonna look. And you go, oh look, there's some raisins.
I'm gonna play that 100 more times before 10 o'clock.
What are the smells? Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel? What does it actually smell like?
All right, 51 minutes away from Laura Korn. She is, of course, I guess a sex therapist, best-selling author. She's written numerous books. She's got a book called 101 Nights of Great Sex, 101nights.com, Tap T Seduce. She's got an app. There's an app for that. She's a best-selling author. She's going to have the maneuver of the night. We'll do that in about 51 minutes, but right now we have a very special segment, brand new here to
this
the web.
This is the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week.
Yeah, we definitely need to spruce it up with some music. Pull up some Def Leppard. You pull up some Def Leppard, and we'll play that behind Jay Wilson, who joins us here from Red Mountain Entertainment right here. I've known Jay for 30 years, 29, 30 years.
Yeah.
And just does a fantastic job, and I know everyone he works for, and there's probably one or two or three, maybe four people in this town that have seen more concerts than I have, and he's one of them, because he brings them down. I mean, he was responsible for the Rolling Stones Steel Wheels in 89. I mean, it's amazing stories. And, of course, Def Leppard's going to be one of those bands we're going to be spotlighting later on tonight, but good evening, brother. How are you?
I'm great.
Fantastic.
I had no idea I was going to be following raisins, makeup sex, the maneuver of the week. I mean,
hey. But it's all, you know, it's all tied into rock and roll.
Well, and it's funny because we do this segment called Tony's True Love Stories. And I have to be careful because I want them to be loving in nature. But most of my true love stories or anything that's had to do with intimacy has had to do with some type of concert I've been at.
I can understand that, yeah.
And okay, you can bring the music down, by the way. That's good. And it's amazing to me because we always talk about first dates Mm-hmm. And it used to be movies, and then we're thinking to ourselves, why are you going to a movie? Because you're sitting there with your mouth closed for 2.5 hours. And, I mean, I guess it's a way to get out of, you know, having to talk a whole lot and kind of feel each other out a little bit in a figurative kind of sense. But concerts, really, to me,
are
the greatest. First dates, second dates, third dates, 100 dates. I mean, you can never go wrong because you can actually converse a little bit.
Yep.
You can dance a little bit. You kind of find out what you're all about a little bit. And then if you're having a good time and you're feeling the vibe, who knows where it's going to go, right?
That's exactly right, yeah.
So give me, and this is kind of, we're flying by the seat of our pants. You know what we do around here. But yeah. We know we're going to end up. Give me one of your favorite concerts of all time. Not so much from a date standpoint, but just one concert that just absolutely blew your socks off, because I know you've seen thousands.
Well, I surprised my wife when we were dating, and I picked her up at work at 8 o'clock one morning. I didn't tell her what we were doing, and went and got her, and we drove out to the airport and jumped on a Southwest flight and flew to Chicago and hit all the tourist traps in Chicago, the museum and all that stuff. And then we went out to the Rosemont Horizon and saw U2 play that night.
See, and that's...
It was awesome.
Yeah, that's good.
And went back to the hotel and...
had a great night.
Got up the next morning, flew home, and had her back at work, early in the morning.
That's awesome.
That was a really memorable, fun little 24 hours.
That is good.
And U2's, one of my favorite bands. All the passwords on my bank accounts, what's your favorite group? It says U2. So,
really?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. I love it.
What is one of your favorite shows?
I got to tell you, I mean, from my youth, it was Def Leppard, Pyromania was... when I was young, but that was my one of my first. The other, though, I was older when I saw them, was AC/DC, sort of towards the end.
They played Atlanta last night, today, or 2 nights ago.
Yeah. I've seen the Eagles. I've seen Van Halen, an amazing, amazing show, early Van Halen. I'll tell you one that, for me, that I sort of found myself at. Now I'm going to disclose. So I was dating a woman who was convinced she was Apollonia. Right.
She swore,
She was Apollonia, and she explained to me, I was 16, 17. She explained to me that it was very important. She was a very erotic person, and that she was just sort of identified with the whole Apollonia thing. And the next thing I know, I find myself at a Prince concert on the floor. Which, not on the floor.
Oh, on the floor level seats.
Floor level. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much.
But, one of those things where I wasn't a huge Prince fan, but just kind of and felt very out of my element down on the floor. But, man, once he came out with the guitar, that's one of the best concerts I had.
Yeah.
Sheila E. was there and all that kind of stuff. I mean, the dude could play the guitar. I mean, it was unbelievable. So it's those kinds of things. I was going to also say, too, as a psychologist, what I think is really interesting, it's not just your dates at concerts. But think about when you've gone to a concert with friends and who you've seen, like the vision, that guy, that girl, you're there with friends, you're not, and whether you hooked up with them or not, it's just, concerts just have this amazing way of transporting you, you bring them here. And you can have a memory of, the woman that you saw, maybe you never see again in your life, but you saw her at the U2 concert.
Yeah.
Or you saw her at... when Tesla was playing.
And I think what's gotten so good, certainly over the last, say, 10 to 15 years, is everyone used to come out with an album, and then they had to go on the road to support that album, because that's where they made their money. Now it's totally flipped.
Right.
Now you don't have albums. People are releasing songs on iTunes, and now they're touring into their 70s and early 80s, but they're still selling, and they still sound so good. And that's the amazing thing to me.
Yeah.
Cool. I'd say Steely Dan was probably the last concert I saw at the concert hall was... The seats obviously were fantastic. Thank you very much. But I mean, it was I did. Thank goodness. But it was fantastic. And the funny thing is, Def Leppard was my first concert at Dayton Arena, and Billy Squire actually was the headliner. Def Leppard
opened for
had just come out with High and Dry, and, mm-hmm. and they started, and more people showed up to see them, the opening act, as Billy Squire. And so it kind of flipped. But that was my first show.
So what? Someone good?
I mean, Def Leppard is. We're very excited about them coming.
Dude, it's amazing. They're still kicking ass. It's killing.
They're doing bigger business than they ever have. They're great. They just. I mean, we listened to the radio spot that the guys in Houston cut when we put the show on sale, and It's just hit after hit after hit.
Oh, yeah.
Got Poison's the opening act.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tesla's going to be the third act. So it's, if you like rock,
yeah,
I mean, you're going to hear 30 plus hits that night down in Tuscaloosa. So it'll be, it's going
to
be fun.
And it's a great, it's a great facility too. It's a great place to watch a concert.
So what also is different, which I think, what's also different, which I think is really great with technology now, you know, now if you're from the Def Leppard era or from the U2 era and you have kids or you got whatever, they know all the songs too.
Well, yeah, and it's not even an era anymore.
That's,
I mean,
what I'm saying.
I mean, there's 16-year-olds going to Allman Brothers concerts.
That's right.
I mean, it's crazy. We're going to do another segment. Jay Wilson from Red Mountain Entertainment joins in the studio. This is the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week. And every single week, we're going to be doing some ticket giveaways. We'll have some Slossfest tickets to be given away. We'll do some Slossfest tickets towards the end of next segment. Of course, your phone calls as well as 545-9950, 844-455-9950. Spotlight continues next here on the web on Talk 99.5.
Birmingham's Real Talk. This is the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week.
I mean, my woofer's just shook. I'm going to get him just to say my name several times.
Can
you
say
play
my
at
name?
Home.
No. Can you say my whole raisin thing with his voice?
I will transcribe that for him.
For the right money, he'll say whatever you want him to.
Oh, yeah.
He's great. He listens to the show. And he's a Birmingham guy. He's fantastic. Does great work. Sloss Fest tickets on the way. John Legend's coming to town. Rod Stewart, Def Leppard's going to be at Tuscaloosa. Soundgarden and more. We have Jay Wilson from Red Mountain Entertainment. This is the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week. We spotlight shows. We're going to spotlight lots of things. We're talking about some of our favorite concerts. And we did so many things when classic rock came on the air in 1988. Mm. I remember actually being out at Oak Mountain Amphitheater, and I mean, I loathed the place because I was out there 6 or 7 nights a week. I was like, we got another classic rock was so hot.
Huge.
And it's come back around. It's just an amazing thing. And I also remember when, I guess, the Eagles were here when the hell freezes over, and we were dropping $100 for a ticket. I'm like,
yep.
This is unbelievable. And it was worth every dime. I mean, it was like, and a lot of people were like, this isn't going to fly. People aren't going to pay this. Oh,
yes,
yeah, they will. For the experience
of the Eagles.
That's what you'll do, which is pretty amazing stuff. So we'll have some tickets to be given away and some more spotlights coming up here in a second. Let's go to Uncle Monster. Uncle Monster, welcome into the web on Talk 99.5. What's up?
Oh, good evening, fellas.
Good evening.
I heard you talking about concerts. I just happened to turn you on. I was on, perusing YouTube, and I came across an audio recording of a Buckingham Nicks concert in 1974 in Tuscaloosa. And I think I was one of the people hollering in the background. I was there, and I went, oh, cool. somebody saved a recording.
I bet my first boss Tony Ruffino promoted that show down there.
I bet you're right.
Oh, it was. I saw a lot of concerts in Tuscaloosa back in the early '70s, and you talk about memories. Of course, I was the sober person. I never messed with drugs, but good grief, all my friends were tripping their brains out. I never could understand that. Why do you want to go see a concert and then take drugs to alter?
Well, it's supposed to supplement the experience. You're not supposed to get so high you don't remember it.
Or some bands are so bad it makes them sound better.
That's good. point taken, yes.
Well, no, actually they were fantastic. It was like a small venue. It was one of the, I think it was one of the halls at the university down there. But, they were incredible. I mean, Lindsey Buckingham on his guitar. And, of course, the Stevie Nicks, she sounds like she's got a handful of gravel in her throat.
That's what makes her sound good.
But it was amazing. It was just, I guess it was just an amazing time.
Uncle Monster, we appreciate the phone call. We got to fly. Thank you very much. The web on 99.5. And, of course, we have Jay Wilson in the studio.
You know what I think is so amazing? So, Jay, I was telling you, I'm born and raised in L.A. So, my concerts, and because of my age, were at long before Staples Center. This was Great Western Forum.
Yeah.
And one of the things that when I first moved here, I was listening to you on classic rock, I realized that not every band always came through with, I mean, again, growing up in L.A., it was just that they were there. They were there all the time, et cetera, et cetera. But what I also realized was how much more, dedicated people, like when someone was coming to town, because they didn't always come to town, or if they were coming across somewhere in the Southeast, people went. People went, they drove up to go see them, or they made sure they could say, growing up in L.A., you were very spoiled. It was like, they'll be here for 5 nights, they'll be here 6 times, et cetera. So it's totally different.
I mean, we do a lot of shows in Shreveport, Baton Rouge, Jackson, Mississippi, Biloxi, Huntsville, and we see exactly what you're talking about. Not all the shows play there, so by golly, when the band decides to play there, it's a special moment. So
yeah.
Well, and so let me tell you one other thing, which is I saw Rascal Flatts out at Oak Mountain, and I live close there. And I think I told you this story. I
when the concert was over, it took me from the time it took me to leave, and I stayed for the whole concert, leave, go to the parking lot, and get to my house was 12 minutes. And I remember thinking growing up in L.A., it was about 2 hours from the time the concert was over to the time you could actually get home, even if you live 15 miles from there, which 2 hours, that's, you can go see a concert in Huntsville. You can go anywhere you guys are putting the concerts on. So it's such a different scene, and I love it. That's what I love about being here. There's much more of a dedication.
Jay Wilson joins the studio of the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week. We'll have some Lost Fest tickets to be given away here momentarily. But people always want to know what happens back in the green room. And, of course, we've heard about the Van Halen. They went the green M&Ms and blah, 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 blah. Who was the biggest pain in the ass you ever had to deal with? Can you say?
Well, I tell you, what's the guy's name from Whitesnake? David Coverdale?
Yes.
Yeah, we did a show at the arena. Whitesnake was opening for somebody, maybe David Lee Roth or something. And he had his girlfriend, Tawny Catane or whatever her name was, there. And she was a piece of work. And she was demanding, and she was giving us more of a hard time than the acts were.
So, really?
Yeah. I would have to say David Coverdale's little entourage was pretty
I think we actually gave away tickets for that show, and I think you had to go to Ed's Pet World and reach into some white snakes to get a pair of tickets underneath, something like that.
That doesn't surprise me. But, you know, nowadays it's mellow. I mean, there's none of that stuff happens anymore.
Why is that? Why?
I don't know. It's more serious. It's more big business. It's more fine-tuned with the crews and the production. You know, bands have iPhones and laptops, and they got everything that they want backstage. So they herbal teas. I mean, it sounds really silly, but it's just a much more straight-ahead, time now.
And you would think some of the older rock and rollers, like the Def Leppards and the Bob Segers, that still are just knocking it out of the park, you'd think they'd be a little cranky, but it seems like they're actually, like Steely Dan, they didn't tour forever. They didn't have to. And all the studio players and their albums weren't making squat. They wanted to go on the road. And now it looks like they're just having a hell of a good time.
Well, they're making so much money that they're traveling in a style that is off the chart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They have tons of people to take care of them. You know, a lot of these people are sober.
Yeah.
So back in the 70s, 80s, whatever, they were out of control. And now it's all about the business and bands like, I don't know anything about Def Leppard and any of that stuff, but it wouldn't surprise me if they're all sober and just straight ahead having a real time,
Sobriety's good in it.
Clears things up.
All right, we're going to keep you one more second. Is that cool?
That's fine.
Is he going to tell us about, I want to hear Tony Curry stories.
Oh, no.
I
had to sign an NDA before did we
you?
Did
that. Oh,
it's all going to be at least 15 years ago. I'll do that.
Oh, God.
Getting on it.
What I want to hear from listeners. I want to hear about good concert stories.
All right. Give us a call. 844-455-9950, 545-9950. And I promise whether it's Lost Fest tickets, we'll give this away next right here on the web on 99.5. At the web, 995, thewebradioshow.com. We're on till 10 o'clock every Saturday night right here on Talk 99.5's The Web. Farm Insurance, the discount double check, the whole nine yards, 985-7799 for all your insurance needs. It is.
Birmingham's Real Talk.
This is the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week.
All right, Jay Wilson in the studio here from Red Mountain Entertainment. You gave me five shows you wanted to talk about. Sloss Fest, we'll have tickets for that. John Legend, Rod Stewart, Def Leppard, Soundgarden. That's just a few of the many. We're going to go ahead and talk about those shows in just a second. Let's go to Tow Truck Rob real quick, though. Tow Truck, what's up?
Man, I am hooking out here late at night.
Love it.
Rain. Yeah. When I was stationed in Virginia, when I was active military, I was in Newport News. I was real close to Norfolk. I saw a lot of different shows at the Norva, which is a very popular venue there. But one of the best shows I ever saw was at the John Paul Jones Arena right outside Richmond, Virginia. It was like 90-something thousand people, and we saw Luke Bryan and Jason Aldean together.
Wow.
And that had to have been one of the greatest country shows I've ever seen in my life. And then also, me and my wife went and saw Slipknot last year at the Oak Mountain Amphitheater, and I have to say, they put on a very big show since they haven't been here in about 10 or 12 years. So that was definitely the two of my top best shows I've ever seen.
Man, appreciate the phone call, man. Thank you so much.
You got to love a guy who goes from Luke Bryan.
I mean, come on now. How good
is
that?
Awesome.
All right, we got
That's a musical palette right there.
No doubt. All right, so we got five shows, and I know you got other shows you want to talk about. Give me some details on these five shows.
I picked a couple of shows just, you know, knowing that what kind of show this is and that sex is like an underlying kind of deal.
Yeah.
So, you know, the Rod Stewart, Cindy Lauper show on July 9 in Tuscaloosa, we're excited about.
That's a great pairing.
You know, just looking up some songs from, in 77, a song with Hot Legs, remember that?
Yes.
78, Do You Think I'm Sexy? Yeah. I mean, Rod the Bod is a sex symbol, you know, so we're very excited to have him coming to Tuscaloosa.
He's still, I saw the video for Broken Arrow. Do you remember that song? He did Broken Arrow when he was married to Rachel Hunter. And
Yeah,
the guy's
he's a stud. Yeah, he's 70-something years old and looks fantastic. The shows are killer.
Yeah.
So Cindy Lauper's a great opening act. So it's going to be a good full night. The other one, John Legend. You know, a lot of ladies think Mr. Legend is a hunk, but I personally like his wife, Chrissy Teigen.
Yeah, yes. I hear you, brother.
She is very, very active on social media, and she's not shy. So, All of Me is the big ballad that he dedicated to his wife.
Yep.
We were talking about it in our office the other day. That video has over 1 billion views on YouTube.
Yeah.
A billion views of All of Me.
It hits every age, right? I mean, you know, my kids listen to it, and your kids listen to it, and my mom listens to it. I mean, that's one of those songs, and he's got such a great voice.
Yeah, John Legend is a superstar. He's playing in Tuscaloosa at the amphitheater on May 16th, so we're psyched about that. And then, you know, if you want to rock, Soundgarden, one of the early, you know, Seattle bands that were the, you know, forefathers of grunge, along with Nirvana, they're coming to Tuscaloosa.
They've been around for a while, man. They've borne it out. They've done.
They
great.
Have, but you know, they haven't toured that much.
I was going to say,
and they have. I can't think of the last time they played Birmingham, but or this area. So, Saturday, May 6th, it's an easy Saturday night drive down to Tuscaloosa. Soundgarden show selling real well, so it feels like it's going to be a big show. So we're excited about that.
All right, and get into Sloss Fest. I know we got some tickets to be giving away, and I know you got 40 acts coming. It's going to be unbelievable.
Yeah, we spend a lot of time putting this thing together. It's four stages, 40 bands, July 15th and 16th at Sloss Furnace. It's a great historic backdrop to do a two-day festival. This will be our third year. Alabama Shakes, Widespread Panic, Sturgill Simpson, Odessa, which is a cool EDM act. And then, again, because of the type of show this is, I wanted to focus on two very hot females that are going to be playing, Fanagram and Kay Flay.
Oh,
so, so we're excited, and it's about 100-something days away, and we're putting it together.
And I love to bend your ear because, I mean, I've known you for forever, and But I still am amazed by some of the stories I get. So if I ask you something that is a little too personal or you don't want to divulge in, just flip me the bird.
Or just tell him. Just say something about
just him. Remember, I've got a limo story.
Yeah. See, that's what I was just going to say.
If you flip me the bird, I'll ask you again. Can you give me, I can't say this. Is there any great concert stories you have? Not necessarily from your standpoint.
Like
from
a friend.
I mean, people want me to write a book. And I'd love to do it. I've been kind of writing down things, and I'm like, you know, good stories don't sell books. Juicy stories do, and I think I've got enough of those just from the backstage areas of Oak Mountain Amphitheater. And now, obviously, you guys do shows from coast to coast. Has there anything happened at a concert that just really amazed you, that you were like, what in the heck is going on here, that you could divulge?
You know, it wasn't at Oak Mountain. It was downtown at the arena. And, again, it was David Lee Roth. Mm. The show was over. It involved a shower and a female, and that's
about
probably
it.
All I can say. But there was all of his reputation was true.
Yeah,
interesting.
And I probably had more experiences on tour buses than I actually have, because I had a night with Hank Williams Jr.
I got that one wrong.
Yeah.
That's one of your true lies.
I come traipsing at 7:30 in the morning, and I was living with a woman, and boy, she's like, I said, you ain't going to believe it, not I had. And she's like, I don't care if you're on Jesus Christ's tour bus. If you ever do this again, and I knew that was the end of that deal. And then I get bit by Frank Beard's dog when ZZ Top came to town. I didn't realize they kind of had their own three tour buses, and they didn't even see each other until they got on stage, and they were gone,
right,
and still killed it. I mean,
right,
just unbelievable. And you want to get it all the way back down to the Five Points Music Hall days. You know, David Lee Roth had a tour bus at that thing once.
Yeah. Now, that's when our company had Five Points Music Hall, that's when I was living in San Francisco.
Yeah.
I took a little 10-year sabbatical out there and managed bands for a while. So.
I mean, Hootie and the Blowfish, that was one of the first, yeah. I mean, one of the, and they just, I mean, it was one of the situations where they had them come in, and then all of a sudden they blew up before they got here, and people were like, they're playing where? And that was a great
venue. I remember one of our team members, Jill Wheeler, mentioned that, told me Fish played there once at 5 points. I mean, you know, now they're selling out amphitheaters everywhere. So,
I mean, it's just, yeah. I mean, Cheap Trick was a concert that I brought in down there, down at 5 points music. Oh, you guys have been part of so many. And I wanted to ask you that before we do that. I know people are like, give away the damn tickets already. I was at the press conference in 1989 when Steel Wheels Rolling Stones tour came through Legion Field, and I really thought during Sympathy for the Devil the upper deck was coming down. I mean, I was up there and I was like, that thing was shaking. I was like, this old lady's coming down to the ground. I really did. I thought it was over.
Those shows were a ton of work.
I forget how many semi-truckloads of stuff, the inflatable woman with the, I mean, but talk about what that, and how that's changed from 1989 to now to 2017. Is it, you talk about the logistics being easier. They got two different shows going at the same time. But, I mean, just talk about that, because that really put Birmingham on the map,
at least in my era. There was a
moment
where we were lucky enough to work with a big national company that had their tours. But we did two Stones dates, a U2 show, a Pink Floyd show. They all played Legion Field over probably a 5 or 8 year period. And, you know, they brought us in as the local folks to help put it together. And, you know, we just built a team and had a ton of stagehands and built a bunch of steel and big stages and all that stuff. And, you know, nowadays it's a little more, the production's easier, and the show, we don't do that many stadium shows anymore because, you know, giant companies, you know, buy the whole tour. But they still go out and play stadiums, but the staging's simpler, but the production's bigger.
Yeah.
But I don't know, it's flashier production, but it's easier to do. So.
Well, I mean, just look at the Super Bowl show.
Yeah.
The Super Bowl halftime show is like, how the hell they get all that together, and then it's gone in 5 minutes. It's like, and that used to take a week.
With video walls and moving lights, it's more compact, but it's more impactful. You know, back when the Stones played at Legion Field, it was a little more, archaic.
Yeah.
But still, they were unbelievable, and it was fun.
All right, we're going to do your segment every single week, and we're going to highlight a band, and we're going to do some ticket giveaways. We do this every single Saturday night between 7
talk
and 10
some music.
In the room. We'll do it. But you got some Sloss Fest tickets, July 15th and 16th.
Yeah, let's give away a pair of general admission weekend.
Sounds good.
Nice.
You know, those are basically $100 and something a piece. Awesome. In fact, right now we're at our level one pricing, which is $115 for 2 days, which is dirt cheap.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Think about that. I mean, most shows now, if you go and see one show, it's $75 to $100.
Yeah,
and you get 40 bands. Yeah, that's
you
good.
Can go see 40 bands. I mean, Sturgill's a headliner. We're doing him at the Wharf. You know, he's going to do 10,000 people, and Alabama Shakes are big. So we got a lot of Widespread Panic plays the arena. I mean, those bands on their own are $50 to $100 a ticket. So right now, through early next week, we're at level one on our general admission tickets for $115. So that's a pretty good deal. And that's they're going to move up to the next level. So let's give away a pair of tickets.
All right, let's do it. 545-9950, 844-455-9950. Again, 545-9950. We'll take caller number two. Caller number two has got a pair of tickets for General Admission, all weekend tickets for Sloss Fest coming to town on the July 15th and 16th. Man, we had a great time
this
catching up with you.
Thanks, guys.
Anytime you want to come up in the Red Mountain Entertainment Spotlight of the Week, we greatly appreciate their sponsorship here on the web. They're going to join us every single week on Saturday nights. And more ticket giveaways as well. Again, call number 2-545-9950, 844-455-9950. Going to Sloss Fest right here on the web on Talk 99.5.
You're in the web. Call 545-9950.
845-9950 or 844-455-9950. Now, back to the web.
Congratulations to Sam of Birmingham. He picked up these Sloss Fest tickets. And a special thanks again to Jay Wells. I could sit here and reminisce about that stuff.
It was great to watch you. Like, you were just in your
element.
Just,
I mean, it's just, it's you want to talk about triggers and things that, you know, we talk about music, and I do a song of the day every day. It's something that just kind of touches me a little bit. I don't care whether people like it or not, but music therapy to me is so underrated. I mean, I think it's just something that really transforms us. It's amazing how often a song can not only get you through something, but can also get you into something.
And get you back to something if you need to do some work.
I mean, it's just, and I listen, I've been a radio disc jockey for nearly 40 years, and I've played it all, and I can't tell you how many times it will just totally transform my mood 95% of the time in a better mood, and just get me hyped up to the extent that there's no return, and I love it. I mean, it's just great. And the concert experience, it doesn't get any better. No. I mean, you can talk about people that love to go to movies, or they're like, going to a great concert, there nothing beats it. I mean, when it's good. There's only one thing, and Jay even brought this up, and I appreciate him his candidness. It sucks when you go to a show and you're really expecting something special. It's not. Yeah. And I know Bon Jovi played a couple weeks ago, and people are like, "What the hell?" The first six songs, they didn't know what they were. And I understand they got new wares they want to sell. But there's nothing better when you go to a Bob Seger or a Def Leppard, they're drilling it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's great.
It's music is so, it's for women too, but particularly guys. I see this with guys who have a hard time kind of, I hate to say this, getting in touch with their feelings or whatever. A lot of times I will tell them, I'll tell you what, when you're by yourself, you're driving or whatever, put some music on. Put some music on that you know is going to not just put you in a good mood. That's great, but that's going to pull at your heartstrings a little bit. You know, you one of your songs of the day a couple days ago was Triumph.
Magic Power.
Man, God. I was getting all emotional because it just brought me back. It brought me back to a time. It brought me back to a time. And that's really important for us. Now I'm being a psychologist. It's very important for us to emote. And sometimes we got to do it in privacy. And that's the great thing about music. Sometimes it's hard to just kind of sit there and go, okay, I got to feel sad, or I want to feel, put the music there, close your eyes, and you are back there. And it doesn't have to be bad time.
And that's to me, I'm not a big YouTube person. People watch YouTube for 6-7 hours a day. That's one of the great things I love about YouTube is when you pull up a video, it'll give you 6 or 7 different pages of stuff that's remotely close to that. And you're like, oh, wow, I forgot about that song.
Yep.
That's pretty cool. And I mean, if you can't find a song on that bad boy, it doesn't exist. All right, let's get some phone calls here. 545-9950. 844-455-9950. It's a Saturday night. We're blowing the doors off. Laura Korn's going to be coming up here in about 7 minutes.
Make sure the kids are in bed.
With
her. Or actually, yeah. And even if the kids are in bed.
Yes, we're talking the young ones.
Hamburger Heaven or Spy for Rent before the show.
Because the maneuver of the
maneuver of the
day is going to be coming up here. Let's go to Dave. Dave, welcome into the web here on Talk 99.5. How are you?
Oh, I'm good. How about you guys?
We're good.
Good. You got some concert stories, I hear. I got some, too.
Let's hear.
I don't know how many times I've seen Widespread Panic, but they kill it every night.
They do. You
know, they'll sell out 3 nights in a row in the same city and really show it up there. Saw Smashing Pumpkins on Valentine's night at the music hall there.
I remember that show, yeah.
Yeah, that was a good one. And then, of course, Van Halen was a bucket list gig for me, so seeing them last year was pretty good, too.
Hey, Dave, appreciate the phone call, man. Thank you so much.
You bet.
I remember I took my Bruce Springsteen played here, and he hadn't played here in years and years and years, and I remember it was one of the only concerts on his schedule that didn't sell out, and he played here, and the night before, it was sold out for the Bass weigh-in.
Oh, my God.
For the Bass Pro. And I remember thinking there was 15,000 people down there to watch guys weigh in their 12-pound bass. And then Bruce Springsteen came. But, I mean, this has been a walk-up town.
Yeah,
you got to get a little bit of a rhythm. But I remember going to see Bruce Springsteen. It was a bucket list show. Not a huge Bruce Springsteen fan. I'm a 10th Avenue Freeze, that kind of guy. Yeah. But I went and saw the show, and it was a top five show for me. And I went back to look at the set list and didn't know but five songs. And I played classic rock, for God's sakes, for a living. I didn't know any of his music, but it was incredible.
Oh, I got a Bruce Springsteen song. So I saw a story. I got a Bruce Springsteen story, and I have no time. I saw Bruce Springsteen at the Rose Bowl.
Oh, wow.
At the Rose Bowl. Sold out. I had a buddy who was a diehard Springsteen fan, and I was like you. You know, I knew about Born to Run and Thunder Run. I knew, yeah, like five songs. Okay, I'll go. And we went, and we got to our seats, and it reminded me, there's, I think it was a Bugs Bunny cartoon. We got to our seats. We paid a lot of money for them. They weren't great seats, but this was the Rose Bowl seats, what, 100,000 people? Yep. And there was a giant, like, speaker. Literally, you couldn't see anything. I mean, sitting right around, I'm like, oh, what the fuck? Guy taps me on my shoulder, and he says, sir, Mr. Springsteen, they changed the setup. Mr. Springsteen has gone and designated certain seats because we've changed everything. Please come with me.
Oh, no, you kidding.
Second row.
Oh!
Okay, now, no. It was both good and it was bad. I mean, good because I look back and, you know, 100,000 people. Bad because you are with the most diehards, and, you know, Springsteen's been around long enough.
Yeah.
These are folks almost at the time when they were like my parents' age, and it reminded me of Name That Tune. Remember the show Name That Name?
Uh-huh.
Because one bar, and everyone's singing, and like, okay, I have absolutely no idea.
But wasn't it one of your greatest concert experiences?
No, it
not
was.
Only because you're in the second row, but I mean, he played every song like it was the last time he was going to play.
He did, and it was like 3 hours long.
Yeah.
And being amongst, you know, 100,000 people was just...
Hey, we know quality wins, whether it's concerts or whether it's food, and Hamburger Heaven just knocks it out of the park every single time. They are the Rose Bowl of hamburgers is what they are. French fries, chicken tenders, shakes, sandwiches, deli sandwiches, the cheeseburgers. I get the number four. The cheeseburger is unbelievable. And all the food is made right there as you order it. You can watch it get a little ground beef there, a little ball round beef, and pump you up and get a little Hamburger Heaven there. I love it. Kirk Roberts and Sons have made the best hamburgers for years. Proud to have them sponsor of our show, The Web, here. And even their veggies are cut every single morning. They're sure freshest. What I love about them, too, is they got the soft serve ice cream. One of the few places that does that. We had like a 9-day stint this past summer where we did the soft serve ice cream for the kids like 9 days in a row. It's fantastic. My favorite Hamburger Heaven location, 180 Oxmo Road in Homewood. I had lunch there yesterday. Check out Hamburger Heaven, our third hour of The Web on Talk 99.5. We're blowing the doors off every Saturday night from 7 to 10. Laura Korn, author, best-selling 5 million copies of her books. She's coming up here next. Look out for the maneuver of the week. Laura Korn next on The Web. It's Curry and Claypo on Talk 99.5. It is not intended to be used in lieu of medical advice or emotional therapy. You should regularly consult a physician or other licensed health care provider concerning all matters that pertain to physical or mental health, particularly any symptoms that may require professional attention. Content on the web may not be suitable for younger audiences. Listener discretion is advised.
Love. Lust. Life. You've just entered the web with Tony Curry and Dr. Josh Klapo. Call 545-9950 or 844-455-9950 or tweet at the web 995 to get on the show.
All right, stellar first couple hours here on the web on Talk 995. I'm Tony Curry from Jocks 94.5. Do a show without Greco and Jay Barker back at you on Monday morning, breaking down the March Madness, the brackets, and everything else. And, of course, do this show on Saturday nights with my good friend, Dr. Josh Klapo. He'll be a clinical psychologist. He's been on everything and done everything and has written every article and been interviewed for every article when it comes to relationships. Am I correct? Right?
Yes. You know, and you know I'm on during the week. Right here on 995.
Yes.
So I'm on with Richard Dixon. Thursdays. Couch Talk with Richard. Couch Talk with Dixon.
I like that.
He likes it. He thinks it's a little dirty.
Yeah.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles.
There you go. They have it.
And then, of course, political psychoanalysis every Wednesday morning with Matt and Ani.
How
does it feel in your mouth?
Ask Ani.
How does it feel in your mouth?
I saw her at Hacienda Mexican Restaurant on Friday night.
I was with my wife
and my kid and ran into her and her lovely husband, and they were kidless for the night. They were having
nice.
A couple back there, and then I ran into Jim Dunaway today.
How does it feel in your mouth?
Subway. I was like, man, I'm just running all these radio...
Because you all live around there.
I don't want to live around radio, TV, / personality.
You do.
No, I don't.
No, but you do.
Bad enough having Rick Carly as a neighbor.
Is he a neighbor?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
He's a good guy. He's a nice guy. I run into him.
The whole Oak Mountain area is
It's crazy.
Ronnie and I are neighbors.
All right, so...
Okay.
We do have a programming change. Laura Korn is, unfortunately, she's not going to be able to join us. She had something personal come up, and she's fine.
Yeah.
But she'll join us again next Saturday, and she's got this maneuver of the week, and she is stoked. She loves the show. She's tweeting it out, and she's out at Santa Monica, and she's got probably more people out in that area listening to the show than we do here, which is amazing. So she's huge. She's an award-winning author and a bestseller, so we hope she's okay and she'll be fine.
You can
have it on
hang on
Saturday.
To your pink breakfast.
Exactly.
Pink breakfast for Sunday mornings.
Yeah, and we hope you don't mind, but we just kind of went off the page a little bit with Red Mountain Entertainment. I could sit here and talk about concerts for like four hours. I just love it.
They define us. They define us. I mean, you talk about... things that are, you know, emotionally stirring and intimacy. I mean, again, it doesn't have to be the concert itself, but it's the memory of that concert.
Yeah.
Or think about it. I mean, I don't know about you, but I can think of amazing concerts that I went to that really define these great periods of my life. I can also think of a few concerts that I went to where the aftermath of it was horrible. And I don't mean...
What do you mean aftermath?
Relationship-wise.
Oh.
I can think of breakups after concerts. I can think of breakups during concerts.
What was the worst concert experience that you've ever had? And I mean, you could say it just sucked, or you had a big argument, or it could be all-encompassing. What was the worst? Do you have one?
I'm thinking.
I will tell you this. The Grateful Dead played here.
Yeah.
In back-to-back nights, and I want to say it was 93 or 4. Jerry Garcia was still alive. And they played down the BJCC. And again, I was doing afternoons over Classic Rock, so I was getting up at 7 o'clock at night.
Right.
And I had six of my best buddies at my house. I left the door open right down the street here in Homewood. And I got there, and each person brought something different to the party.
Yes.
And I knew that I had about 20 minutes to consume as much of whatever I could get my hands on to.
Oh, yeah.
And so I get down there, and I had never been to a Grateful Dead concert. I had never followed the band. I knew Touch of Grey just coming out, which is a great song, and I'd heard Truckin' and Casey Jones and all that stuff. But I mean, just based on... So I get there, and I see people, you know, in the fetal positions, you know, looking for miracles, doing that. And I'm going, what in the hell is going on here? And so I'm in my seat, and this guy looks up at me and goes, dude, you're going to puke. It's okay. It's all right. And I was like, what are you talking about? And I mean, evidently I was as wide as a ghost. And so, I didn't, by the way. I was fine. And then About 3 months later was my birthday, and I was in Atlanta.
For your birthday.
At a place called the Gold Club with my bosses and stuff. They took me over there for whatever reason. I was driving. And I took a wrong turn out of the Gold Club. It was kind of like a little trap, and I took a right turn. Of course, I get pulled over, and I got sent to jail for the night.
Man, you got some stories.
And I remember sitting in an 8x10 holding cell, and the Grateful Dead was playing Atlanta that night. And so I was sitting in a...
With Deadheads?
Ugh. You want to talk about a mess. That's enough to never want to get arrested again.
Yeah, that's really
bad. It was like...
That's really bad.
Dude, it's okay, man. It's like hanging out with 15 John Lennons. I was like, no, I want to get out of here. And I was, you know.
That's really bad.
So my experience with the Grateful Dead, but that being said, I got a picture of Jerry Garcia at Graceland hanging right above my toilet in my bathroom, so I see it every morning.
I don't even know what to say. Got nothing to say on that
You
one.
Got nothing?
I got nothing on that
Well,
one.
I got something I can tell you. 9:12 here on Talk 99.5's The Web. Again, phone calls are always very interesting in the 9 o'clock hour on Saturday nights, 545-9950 at The Web 995. You can also follow us on the website at thewebradioshow.com. And that thing's being constantly upgraded. You can stream us live all over the country. It's great, isn't it?
It is. Rebecca Sandage does an amazing, amazing job. And she looks for emails from me daily. And we've got, it's like the hub. It's this hub of love.
Ooh, I like a that. Hub of love.
It's a hub of love. And so, you know, if you're trying to figure out how to listen to us, if you're not local, if you're trying to figure out latest, you know, videos or whatever, webradioshow.com, it's all right there. And she does an amazing job, including changing logos out, putting in promos, et cetera, et cetera.
All right. So one of our fine sponsors, and we could do it without our sponsors, but it makes it a little easier on us.
Yes.
TD's Fine Furniture, and Butch Drake is a good friend of mine. I've been doing business with him for now about 6 or 7 years, and he really is good. They got 100,000 square feet of merchandise and furniture, and they buy by the shipload, the container, whatever you want to call it, so they get great deals, and they do discontinued stuff and doesn't make a difference. It's not like the 2017 Flex deal is going to be better than 2016. It doesn't matter. It's discontinued stuff, and they save because they buy so much of it. Find thousands of items priced at 30 to 70% off at TD's Fine Furniture now in Summerton with well over three decades. It is fantastic. Every piece of furniture in my house is from TD's Fine Furniture by my choice. Thank you very much. And Butch Drake and his wife, the entire crew, do a fantastic job. It is worth just down the road from all those high prices. It really is. So check out TD's Fine Furniture. Of course, everyone appears on the web on Talk 99.5, appears on the TD's Fine Furniture couch right here on Talk 99.5. Count up here next. Josh Klapo, speaking of news anchors, hangs out with three of them from Fox 6 and gets them to put this small wrinkly thing in their mouth. Next, right here on the web.
You're in.
All right, 9:17 here on Talk 99.5 is the web. The web radio show is Love, Lust, and Life with Curry and Claypo. We do it every Saturday night from 7 to 10 at the web 995 on Twitter, 545-9950. We always get a couple of scragglers coming around 9:30, quarter to 10, so feel free to buzz us now so we get you on. You can call anonymously. You can call about whatever you want. We haven't gotten to anything we wanted to again. We always have this undercurrent of what we want to talk about.
Not all this fantasy stuff.
Well, we still got time, brother.
Okay.
Before we get into it, though, speaking of fantasy, you have been on more mediums, like, in the last 6 months than I think than Ryan Seacrest has been, which is really incredible. And, by the way, Ryan Seacrest loves Laura Korn's book. He just put something out on Twitter.
Did he really?
Yeah. He reads it all the time, he says. And she unfortunately can't join the show, but he's if you go to her webpage, there's a picture of Ryan Seacrest on it. He says, "I love her book. She's great."
Well, her stuff is she's amazing. Yeah. And she's got. I'm glad things are okay, and we'll hopefully see you next week.
So you do a lot of things. You've done National Geographic, GQ. You've done. National Enquirer. No, you've been in National Geographic, have you not?
No.
Oh, is that the one we're trying to get you in?
Yeah.
With the naked pygmies?
Yeah.
Okay.
No naked pygmies.
Bustle, you've done it all, right?
Men's health.
So and you do a lot of local stuff as well, and you were on WBRC Fox 6.
They're wonderful.
Wonderful. And it wasn't really relationship-wise, but it turned into a relationship segment. So you were on with three anchors from Fox 6, and you were doing something called the Raisin Meditation. That's what I said, Raisin Meditation.
Well, that was the other thing. For a lot of folks around here who are from the South thought that it had to do with, like, lifting something up, like a raisin.
Oh, it did. Oh, here it is. It'll raise something up. Go ahead and play it. Go ahead.
When is the last time you actually looked at a raisin?
Never.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles, to the size, and actually process that in your brain. That's the first thing. Second thing, you're going to smell the raisin. Yes,
really?
Yes, you are. Yes,
that
it smells
much.
Like a raisin.
There's a fragrance.
But you're going to pay attention to what are the smells? Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel? What does it actually smell like? You're going to put it in your mouth. You're going to taste the raisin. I'm going to try not to choke doing this. Do not chew the raisin yet. How does it feel in your mouth?
Okay. I started chewing.
How does it feel in your mouth? What's the texture like? What are the flavors like?
Jill, how did you get out of this?
As you're chewing it now, how does that change? Mm-hmm. Now you swallow the raisin. Pay attention to it going down, and now you're going to summarize in your brain, what did you just experience? What did it look like? Pay attention for a minute, remember. What did it smell like? What did it taste like? And what did it feel like as you were eating it?
Okay, I got to object. Mine were given to me by the producer.
That is the money quote
there. She didn't have my raisins.
She had no clue what she was saying.
She didn't have my raisins. Those weren't my raisins. That's never.
See, that's about as cool as you're going to hear. We've had some news anchors in here. We've had some people that are pretty laid back.
The Prater Wiener thing is.
But they're so, for the most part, and it's not their fault. It's not news anchors' fault that they have to be so sterile.
No.
They're just not in a situation
it's
to
news.
Let go because you say any little thing that seems a little half cocked, they're done.
Yep.
And to hear those three women try to meander through that whole situation, not having a clue where you were going with it, I thought was hilarious. We could go to a bar tonight.
I even have a little container for my raisins.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles?
Dude, we have got to go out one night and pull this off.
You can.
You could walk into
it's raisin. It's totally. There's a lot of psychology behind
You're like the magician who shows up at 2 o'clock in the
That's
morning
right.
and picks up the scragglers.
Look at my
because.
Raisin.
You know, like, hey, you got a deck of cards. The next thing you know, you got the woman all over you because you're a magician.
You
she thinks it's real. Yeah. You could walk in with a box of raisins off somebody.
Comes in a special container.
Huh?
My raisins come in a special container. But you know actually why I did that? I brought them a special container because I was so concerned that because we had such a short amount of time that I wouldn't be able to, like, open the box of raisins because it fumbled, they get all sticky and whatever. So I had a very special raisin container. So it has to do with mindfulness and eating.
You are.
You all just warped it into some.
We warped that.
You warped it.
How does it feel in your mouth?
There you go.
We're warping.
Okay, but
that's us warping that.
You are. You have to have the whole picture together.
What are the smells? Is it sweet? Is it sour? Does it smell like caramel?
You did say you were getting close to losing it there, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Just a little bit. Just a little bit. So I got a sexual fantasy question for you.
All right.
I got numbers for you. But, of course, now I can't.
And I have some numbers for you, too, because I knew we were going to get into this tonight.
Okay, good.
And I thought it was kind of interesting because it actually has the frequency of usual and unusual sexual fantasies by gender.
Pay attention to it going down.
And that's not one of them.
Go ahead.
So they went through everything from I like to feel romantic emotions during a sexual relationship, which is pretty doggone just whatever, to I like having sex in an unusual place. I have fantasized with three or more people. I mean, there's all kinds of... I mean,
I think you and I got the same numbers.
It goes on and on and on,
yep.
And which was amazing. And there's like, I don't know, 55 sexual fantasies here by gender. Basically, only two of the sexual fantasies were found to be rare for women or men, while nine others were unusual. 36 were common for one or both of these genders, and only five were typical. But what I found interesting in most of these was I keep hearing about how women fantasize as much as men. I don't believe it.
Why don't you believe
it? Well, I certainly don't think they act out on it. I just don't see it.
What don't you see? Are you a mind reader? Like, what do you mean?
No, I mean I think I'm a pretty well versed guy. I think I've done a little bit of everything in life.
Yes,
and I've certainly been around some strange creatures and some people that like to get out there a little bit.
Do women fantasize?
Not as much as men, but according to this article, they do more so.
Yeah, it's more complex. They're more in their head. I mean, I guess you got to define what you mean.
Maybe it's because I believe men will display it more. They'll tell you. Whereas women just kind of keep it all canned in.
Yeah.
Like, really, you do that? I don't believe you.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's a much more... Women are much more complex when it comes to intimacy and sexual... the sexual experience. And so... And that's... See, I get hesitant because men can be that way, but women are the ones who... It's a much... I can't get away from the damn raisin. They're much more mindful.
Fall, yeah.
They're much more mindful about the sexual experience, on average. On average. They are able to fantasize in a way, very often, that is more rich than their actual experience. So that they can play, because they have, there's no hang-ups in your fantasy. There's no, it's all for you. And so men are more thinking about how am I going to actually do it, and women have a wider palette of fantasy.
And I'm not going to go into detail on these. You can only imagine. I mean, just go as far as you want with...
Well, here's one. I've fantasized about a sexual relationship with a... oh, wait, I lost it. Never mind.
Yeah, exactly. You don't need to go in specifics. You don't. I mean, you don't
cartoon
have to go...
character? Was that where you're going?
Yeah,
No. Here's the one I was thinking about. So this is... over. Who's more, men or women? I've fantasized about having sex with more than three people, both men and women.
I'm going to guess it's probably women because I think you're trying to throw me a curve.
56% women, 15% men.
And really, if you think about it, that would be true because women are much more comfortable being with other women than men are with other men. I would think that most men wouldn't even want to be with another couple because there's another man involved. I'm good.
No, this is... Oh, here's one. I mean, to go back to our earlier call, I fantasize about masturbating an unknown person. Which, who do you think's got the higher percentage of fantasizing about that?
No, I'd like to be on the other end of that.
No, I didn't ask you that.
Oh, that's my fantasy is what that is.
So what do you think, men or women? Who's more likely to say they've had that
No,
as a fantasy?
I mean, it's definitely men.
Yeah, by...
Because, I mean, that's...
One.
Well, yeah. And that's kind of a no-brainer. But, again, well, I don't think we need to get any more specifically than that because, I mean, you can just imagine your fantasies. Right? And what we'll get into coming up on the other side, though, I think is interesting is... What do you do? And it goes back to the Desperate Housewives husband situation where all of a sudden he divulges, hey, listen, I've had these deep, dark secrets for a long period of time, and I really want to act them out. In order to be truthful with you, I need to share these with you. And she's like, you want to do what?
Like dress up?
And then she says, okay, I'll give it a shot, but it's just too weird for her.
Oh, that happens. Oh, dude, that happens. Happens a lot.
But it's almost like being with a totally different person.
Yeah, and then you start getting creeped out because you're starting to wonder beyond the sex, who is this person? Particularly if you've been together for a long time.
Yeah.
Who is this person? What else is there?
That's it right there.
What else is there?
What else is there going on that I don't know about?
Yeah, and people, let me tell you, some very normal people have some very odd fantasies. And we can get into fetishes and those kinds of things, but even if it's not a fetish, I mean, just some of the people's fantasies. I mean, that's what Freud said was so amazing about our brain and our consciousness. I mean, it can go anywhere. And so to me, the question really ends up being is this something that you do tell your significant other? Maybe there are things, sexual fantasies, that are best kept as a fantasy.
As long as you don't act on them, right? I mean, she finds out you're dressing as a woman every Saturday night when you say you're going to play poker with the guys and you're going to, that's one thing. But.
Well, maybe we can ask Laura when she's on our next show, that, is everything fair game? Do you share everything with your significant other, or your partner, about what you fantasize about?
Yeah.
Or do you keep it to yourself?
I would say as long as it's not involving another person. Or blow up apparatus.
Sometimes,
probably good.
Sometimes our thoughts can be pretty bizarre.
But I mean, a lot of people would believe that's cheating then. Because if you have a fantasy and you're not sharing that fantasy and it's taking time away from your relationship.
Nah, that's not cheating.
What are you talking about?
That's cheating.
You've taught me that.
That's not cheating.
If it takes away time from your relationship.
That's not cheating. It's taking time from your relationship.
That's cheating, right?
Not cheating.
Oh, we're going to talk about this thing.
That's not cheating.
I mean, you're backing up on me here.
No, I'm not.
All right, phone calls, 545-995.
Raisin.
The web on Talk Better 95. whenever I throw something on Twitter or something, do you think your wife is cheating? You all would always say, wait a minute, are you talking about sexually? And I'm like, yeah, is there a different type of cheating? And I realize there's other types of cheating, but when you ask 100 people, is she cheating on you? 99 of those guys will say, sexually.
Mm-hmm.
One guy will say she's not because she's probably doing something financial or otherwise. Maybe she's down at the boats gambling, okay? Mm-hmm. But it was my understanding, we were talking about fantasizing and what you should share with your wife and or husband if, in fact, you want to be tied up to a bed or chains or whatever. All of a sudden, it's a fetish of yours and your wife has no clue and you have to be true to yourself. I've always been under the understanding that if it takes anything away from your relationship, time-wise,
the fantasy.
Addiction,
right?
Alcohol, gambling, fetish. If it's taking away from your relationship, being with your wife or your time wise, then it's considered cheating, is it not?
No, not. It's not that black and white. It's never that black and white. So
if I'm spending more time.
Whoa, there you go.
As I said, taking time away.
Taking time? No. Spending more time fantasizing than you are spending with your wife? Yes. Think about the difference.
Okay, so I spend 12 hours with my wife, but 12 and a half hours fantasizing that I'm cheating on her? If it takes any time away from your relationship at all, it's cheating, is it not?
Yeah, no.
If I'm spending Sunday afternoons from 1 to 4 at some weird club downtown instead of spending...
That's not fantasizing.
It is if I've got a fetish and I have fantasies for it.
That's not fantasizing. Fantasizing is in your head. If you're downtown at the club...
Are you fantasizing at a peep show?
Huh? No, that... Fantasizing is, think of it as imagination.
I know what fantasizing
is. Well, that's what I'm talking about. So think about this. You're right. If instead of having sex with your wife, you would rather think about and fantasize about having, even if it's with your wife, having some form of sex and think about it and not have sex with your wife at all, and that's the majority of your time, that's probably not a healthy thing. Is it even cheating? I don't know, but it's not a healthy thing. However, if some of your time is spent fantasizing about your wife or about sexual encounters with your wife that maybe you don't want to tell her about because you don't feel comfortable telling her about it, that is not necessarily cheating because some of those fantasies may not... They may be okay for you in your imagination, but they may not be okay for her in your relationship. I mean, think about it like dreams. We have dreams that we know are not reality, and they stay dreams. They're a way of doing a emotional, psychological fart. Think of it that way.
Oh, that's true.
That's what it is.
They're healthy, aren't they?
They are healthy.
Yeah.
But so what I'm saying is, it's good to share your fantasies with your partner, but it's kind of like oversharing sometimes. You got to be careful about what your fantasies are and what your partner may or may not be comfortable accepting. It may be something, particularly if you know it's something that you're never going to be able to act out or you don't think it's appropriate to act out, keep it to yourself. You don't have to share everything.
I think that's remarkable that it's like, and I totally agree.
Because it depends what it is. So here's an example.
I totally agree.
I'm going to give you an example. I'm going to give you an example. And I'm not saying that you are hung up on this and this is all you think about. I'm not even saying you specifically, Tony Curry. Sometimes you may have a passing thought or a fantasy of a painful sexual interaction, some S&M maybe with your spouse.
Yeah.
You've considered it. You've fantasized about it. You've thought about it. And again, as a fantasy, it plays out in a way that you control the rules. But in your heart of hearts, you may know that even though you're thinking about it or dreaming about it, that's not something that your wife is likely to... Yeah. Right. So what do you do? Do you share it with her just because it's your fantasy?
No.
Right. That's all I'm saying. You should share your hopes. You should share your dreams. You should share your fantasies. But what I'm saying is be thoughtful about it. It's not every fantasy that you have is totally fine to share with your partner at any time. And people do this all the time. Then they go, well, why is she upset? Or why is he upset? Well, he's upset because you rocked his world.
And it's like the girl or the guy who shares an episode of cheating on them from 15 years ago. Because they, and I'm like, why would you tell...
Yeah.
You got to come clean. And a lot of, I understand that. But in most cases, I think it's to make you feel better. Because I get to come clean because it's been wearing me out for 15 years that I cheated on my husband or wife. And they
absolutely
don't need to hear it.
Look, we so often, I tell people this all the time. When you're trying to tell somebody something, trying to be honest with them because you think it's the right thing to do, right? I need to tell the truth. I'm not saying that that isn't the case, but I'm saying before you tell the truth, ask yourself this. Am I telling the truth so that I don't have to walk around with the knowledge of it and I get it off my chest? Or am I truly telling the truth to let the other person know? Because so often we're doing it because we feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
I cheated 15 years ago and I love this person so much and I want them to know so that we can be okay. That's crap. A lot of times. Yeah. That's your secret. You cheated 15 years ago. You got to live with it. You got to figure out how to deal with it. Why bring it up? Maybe it's appropriate, but it's not always appropriate. Dude, it's that uncomfortable zone.
I mean, I love the fact you're saying that because I think a lot of people would say, you got to come clean on something like that because if she finds out about it.
Well okay, so let's play that one out. Yes, okay. if there is a good chance that she or he are going to find out about it, then you got to come clean. You got to come clean because you don't want them to find out about it unless it's from you. But what I'm saying is you do not become an instant open book on everything that's happened at all times just so you can be clear with your spouse. It's not, you got to be more tactful about that. I'm not saying lie. I'm not saying purposely keep things, but I'm saying think about why is it that I'm sharing with you? Do I feel bad? Do I want you to feel better? Is this going to help us?
Yeah, we've had some fascinating talks about when it's time to divulge this type of information, whether it's cheating or whether it's a sexual fantasy, or whether you're like, hey, listen, I really like this person. We've only been out twice, but I know that it's going to come to the surface that this is the way I like to do things. So when do I divulge that? Or when do you tell someone you used to do this? Or I used to be a stripper, or I killed somebody, or did it?
Think about it this way. Do you want to know, if you're listening right now, I'm putting it on you, you're a married man, I'm a married man. Do you want to know everything in your wife's past?
No.
Right. I don't either. I don't. And I know. Well, actually, I don't know. I'm fairly sure that there are things in my wife's past that she hasn't shared with me, that I haven't asked about, and yeah, she hasn't shared with me.
And I wouldn't ask. I don't need to.
No, because when you come into a relationship, look, you come into a relationship and the whole idea of being together and you act as one, and you know, I'm approaching it from a psychological perspective. You are two individuals. You will always be two individuals. No matter how joined you are, you will always be two individuals. And you will always have things that define you and are about you that they may never know. Ever know. Just because you're two individuals.
Yeah.
You're not melding 100%. Maybe you're melding 50%.
And the longer we live, the more you realize we all have major issues.
Oh god, yeah.
I'm talking like even,
yes,
the nice, most humble, purest people that we want to put up here have got some,
they're
pretty
human.
Deep,
look,
dark
think about it. Take it from the religious perspective, original sin.
Yeah.
Take it about, you know, from a psychological perspective, neuroses and sort of early childhood. We all have things that in our life we're trying to adapt and fumble through, and we're all screwed up. It's just how, you know, people ask me all the time, do you think I'm screwed up because of my parents? Yes. But you don't know anything about me. I know you're screwed up parents. And at the same time, let me say this is not all doom and gloom. I see tons of parents who are so afraid, I'm going to say something,
yeah,
and my child's going to be ruined, right, for the rest of their lives. Well, I say, well, look at you. You came out okay. Did your parents say and do things that you felt messed up? Yep. That's the way it is. So the question is, as an individual, what do you do about it?
All right, 944 here on the web on Talk 99.5. Phone lines are open, 545-9950, at the web, 995, and, of course, theWebRadioShow.com. Up till 10 o'clock, we're on from 7 to 10 every single Saturday night, and we love the ship. We hope you're enjoying the show. Dr. Josh Claybo, Tony Curry back in just a few minutes here on the web on Talk 99.5.
With Curry and Clevo.
.948. By the way, I want to thank Maddux for joining us on the show. He's a new addition to our show.
Going to be streaming Facebook Live every week, which means not only will they hear us, but you'll get to see us.
Only during when we're on the air, right?
Yeah, because all the fun stuff's in between.
Good. You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles?
I told some stories during the breaks tonight, and I'm like, oh,
oh my goodness.
Totally forgot, right? We're good, yes, right?
We're good. And Maddux is also creating interesting pictures and putting them
out. You didn't
hear
that story about the Buffett concert, did you?
Did not.
Jay Wilson actually got a little wigged out on that one.
Yeah, that was making me uncomfortable.
It wasn't my fault.
Well, of course
it was,
not.
It was my fault. I didn't know. It
wasn't my fault. There's a real...
I had no idea. It's not like you have someone sign a disclaimer when you go out with them.
No.
Promise me you're telling me that you are who you are.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I guess I probably should have.
That says a lot about you.
There's a lot of things that have happened at concerts.
What happens at concerts stay at concerts. No, they don't.
I could write a whole book about my concert experiences.
Yeah.
And now I think on average I go to maybe one or two a year. But at the time, I was going to Oak Mountain like four or five nights a week. Because when Classic Rock came in the area in 1988,
89.
They were waiting for a radio station to come on so they could support these concerts. And so everything was coming to town. Of course, they still had the lawn out there. New Era owned it. It was fantastic. We had Red Mountain Entertainment in the spotlight. In the studio earlier tonight, and we just sat here and started talking about concerts. I could go on for days.
Well, so now, Lita, think about that. That was in your heyday. And now you're sitting here with a therapist.
I just turned 51. That's about right.
That's what I'm saying.
And really, I can remember more of my stage presence than I can remember. I mean, I had some backstage experiences.
Right.
Stevie Nicks was, you know, we can broach that subject next week.
You and Stevie Nicks? Wow.
We're rolling, so I can't do any facial stuff, right?
No.
See, and I'm glad you brought that up because I was going to do something with my hands, but I can't do it.
But you know Stevie Nicks.
She had just broken her leg.
You helped her.
Like a couple of weeks before.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to...
It's safe here.
...defame her, but I think she was pretty medicated.
Mm-hmm.
And she would walk off stage occasionally during the show to get even more medicated, and she needed some help being medicated.
Ah. Oh.
You know where I'm going?
Yeah, I do.
Do you?
Yeah, I think
what
so.
What are the smells?
And I took my turn.
Yes.
Someone tapped me and said, you're next. I said, okie dokie.
Okie dokie.
So I went back to Green Room during, I think it was maybe Stand Back was a big song of hers. It was like the 8-minute version of Stand Back.
Yeah.
And
this was in your official.
You could honestly say this is a fantasy for probably a lot of guys.
Yeah.
During her time, because she was still the gypsy kind of thing. She had the long robe, but she wasn't fat yet. She wasn't big.
Yeah.
She wasn't there like Ann Wilson big, but she was. She was getting there. She had some meat on her bones. But, remind me, I'll tell you after the show, because I don't think you know where the hell I'm talking about.
I think I do.
Write it down. Write down what you hear.
Yeah.
Write down what you think I mean.
With this bad radio.
Write down what you think I mean, and I guarantee you're wrong.
What? This is a little bad radio.
Not if it's the web. It's great. Can you hold it up to the camera? So people can... Do you know what? It did go there, but do you know what it was?
No.
Oh.
No, I don't. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you understand what I just did there?
Huh? No? You draw pictures now?
Remind me to pick up some smoothie straws on the way home tonight. Because she couldn't take it that way.
Yeah.
She stopped up.
Whoa. It's okay. You want to share any more? But by the way, just in case you ever want to know, psychologists, we don't typically do that.
Do what?
Not that. when a client tells a story, we don't typically go, whoa,
How does that make you feel? It's like what I said to Stevie Nicks.
How does it make her feel?
Yeah.
Or not feel.
There has been some pretty crazy things. And I will say this. There was David Crosby was in town with Crosby, Stills, and Nash.
Different problem.
Yeah, there was a different problem. But he came in, and he went through the green room area. There was a kind of like a concession line, like a cafeteria there, and he didn't like the food. And he was just really cranky in a bad mood. I was supposed to interview him. We were having a meet and greet back in the back with a barbecue joint in town, who I'm not going to mention because I'm going to spend money on this, but they will. and he was just a total a-hole.
Right.
And he was like,
he was hungry.
I mean, well, that's fine. But I mean, I was like, hey, I'm supposed to interview. I was just, and he was like, get out. And
right.
Just, I mean, just a real jerk. I wasn't like being rude. I mean, it was like a jerk.
Did you keep your cool?
You know what I did?
Hmm.
I heard him saying his food stinks. He threw his plate on the ground, blah, blah, blah. So I went and made a plate of his barbecue for him, and I took it up to him.
Oh.
After he called me an F and blah, 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 and I said, I understand you didn't like your meal.
Welcome.
I thought maybe I'd bring some of our stuff to the meet and greet you were supposed to be at. Have a nice night.
Wasn't
a jerk.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Because I knew it when you show up. 5 minutes later, 45-minute interview.
Yep.
Kill him with kindness.
Food.
Well, no, you never,
food, dude. Good, some good.
Yeah, but you never fail when you go take the high road.
You never fail when you take the high road.
It may be short term. You may fail short term. You may think you're, but you never fail when you take the high road.
That's right. Well, it's the same as divulging your fantasies or divulging something to get off your chest. Sometimes taking the high road in a relationship means not doing anything.
It's really difficult to take the high road sometimes, particularly when you have to do it over and over and over and over and over again with the same person. But it's worth it every time.
Yeah. It is, as long as you're moving towards something that's better for you.
From a therapeutic standpoint, taking the high road always feels good for me.
That's good, because for a lot of people, it doesn't.
And I know that taking the high road sometimes, if someone steals my pants, I give them my shirt. Sometimes doing that makes them think, what the hell is this guy got up his sleeve? Yep. Why is he being so nice to me? And that's worth it right there. Now, hold on. Don't get ahead of me. I make sure I'm doing it for the right reason. But if there's that little extra, why is he doing this to me, then I'll take it. But it's not why I'm doing it originally. I'm doing it because it's the right thing.
You're doing the right thing.
But if it does make them wig out and lose sleep one night, why in the hell is this guy so nice to me?
Yeah, that's just a little.
Then so be it. That's not my fault.
Yeah, that's true. That's hard. That's good impulse control.
Yeah.
It's also good. It's a good way of sublimating your sort of primal desires. So, again, the primal desire is I want to put you through the wall. Right? That's the id. That's the bait, you know. And the more evolved is I'm going to be kind to you. I'm going to be fair to you. As long as it's authentic and genuine, that's really hard to do.
And that's not giving in.
No?
Not all the time. Sometimes, I guess, you could be the coward of the county, just let someone beat you down and say, But if you do it for the right reasons and know who you are and know what you believe in and what you stand for, it can be extremely beneficial. And I think very healthy for you because it helps you move on quicker.
It does, as long as you know what to do with that frustration. Because, see, that's what I see. Again, same thing. This is what I see with couples all the time is starts off good, going to take the high road, but he or she pisses you off.
Yep.
And then you revert back to your primal self, and you let them know what you're really thinking at the moment, and you're letting them know what you really think because it makes you feel better.
As always, partner, it was very entertaining, strange, bizarre, and beautiful. I'm not talking about your raisins. I'm talking about the show.
You're going to go home and you're going to look at the raisins.
Give me a copy of that raisin thing there from Fox 6. I want to play it when I get home tonight.
You're going to pay attention to the wrinkles?
Well, I guess my wife can guess what that is. It's the web back at you on Saturday night.